Good morning, students. In today's class, we'll be dealing with chapter 1, that is making of Indian society and demography. So let's move on to the chapter. So when you say making of Indian society and demography, what does come to your mind? See, making of Indian society, we can say how Indian society has been formed and what are the different kinds of society which is being there, and the demography. The demography part, we'll be looking into it later when as we go further into the chapter. So emergency of pluralistic society. So when you say pluralistic, that means many society. So India has a long history and its structure is very complex. According to a popular estimate, it has covered a span of 5,000 years from the period of its first known civilization, which is the Indus Valley civilization. So we can say Indian history or Indian society dates to almost 5,000 years back. So from that time, Indian society is being formed, but there's a lot of changes which is being there in this. During this long period, several waves of immigrants. So immigrants are the people who have come and settled in a different place. For example, someone is from Bangalore, but they have settled in Hyderabad. So they become an immigrant in Hyderabad. Okay. So representing different ethnic strains and linguistic families have merged into a population to contribute to its diversity, richness and vitality. So what happened when people shift one place to another? They have to adapt to that culture which they have been moved. So the ethnic culture of that place, they will adapt, and the linguistic, obviously the language. For example, if you are from Karnataka and you are good in Kannada, but when you have to move to some other place, you have to learn that language so that it will be easy for you to communicate to the people around there. Okay, so it is also becomes the one of the reason for the population to contribute to its diversity, to come diversity where it's the adaptation of everything, like the multilingual thing. Diversity, richness and vitality. So as we move, the richness, the economy also will grow, because when there is a employment opportunity in one place, people tend to move. So what happens, the richness of the culture will become very extremely, it will get a space there. Then several different levels of social evolution coexist in contemporary India. So there are different types of social evolution. So social evolution means the way their people have been changed according to the time, according to the ages. Okay, for example, earlier we didn't have technology as much. There was no internet. So but now you can see the evolution which has been happening, and we tend to adapt to that new evolution which is happening in the society. So primitive hunters and food gatherers, shifting cultivators, nomads of different types, breeders of goats, sheep and cattle, inert traders and artisans and craftsmen, settled agriculturists and landed gentry, as well as aristocrats of the ancient lineage. So these are the people who are the primitive hunters who used to hunt food and gather food for the everyday. Then shifting cultivators, they will shift and cultivate. For example, for 6 months they would cultivate in place and they would just move on and cultivate in other place. Then nomads are the people are the ones who move from one place to the other. So they settle for the sake of the cattle rearing, to rear their cattle and etc. Most of the major religions of the world, Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, Buddhism, Jainism, Zoroastrianism, Sikhism, Judaism, Jainism are found here. And in addition, there are prevailing variety of cults and sects with different orientations in belief and ritual. So we have a lot of cultures. Not just culture, you know, India is a multilingual, multicultural and etc. It just has so many cultures. India is almost called as unity in diversity. Unity in diversity means we have different types of culture, language, religion. We follow different types of things. In the same way, we have so many religions in India. And also different cults are there. For example, Buddhism, Jainism. Under them, we have different religions. For example, under Buddhism, you have Hinayana and Mahayana. Under Jainism, you have... Just guess, children. You have under Jainism also two other sects, which is the... So they are Shvetambaras and Digambaras. So we have different sects under one religion only. Added to this, the modern academy, bureaucratic, industrial and scientific elites, and you will find the past, the present and the future living together. So we have, as it is moved now, okay, so we have industrial, then we have scientific people who study on the science, and then we have find the past and the present. So we'll differentiate always between the past and the present and the future living together. So we will see the future also living together. In the process of its evolution, Indian society has acquired a composite culture. So we have composite culture means many culture characterized by stable patterns of pluralism. So but it is between the stable patterns. So it's not just one society we have. We have different kinds of society which is pluralistic. Next, moving on to the racial groups of India. So what are the different types of racial groups which we have in India? The most authoritative and widely accepted classification by B.S. Guha identifies six major racial elements in the population of India. So we have six major racial groups in India, which is given by B.S. Guha. That is Negroid, Proto-Australoid, Mongoloid, Mediterranean, Western Brassipipeds, and Norkid. So in the south of Kadar, the Irula and the Panyana, and in Andaman Islands, the Ongo and Jarvas of Andamanese have identified Negroid. So the people of this region, that is Kadar, Irul, Panyaman and Andaman Islands, they are called as a Negroid people. Characteristics, some traits of this group are found among the Angiman Naga and the Bagadi of Rajamalai Hills. So these kind of peoples are being found in the main regions of Kadar, Irul, Andaman and also of Rajamalai Hills. On the western coast, there are some groups in pronounced Negroid traits. So some people in the western coast also, they are having the trait of Negroid, but they perhaps represent a later arrival who came to India with the Arab traders. So it is believed that these people, the Negroid, they had come with the Arab traders to India. The Proto-Australoid group is the numerically more significant. Most of the tribe of Middle India belong to it. These were the people described by Most of the tribes of Middle India belong to it. These were the people described by the Indo-Aryans as Anas, Dasas, Dayusa and Nishad, all derogatory terms. So we have the Proto-Australoid group. So they are mostly the people, they are the tribes of the Middle India. So the Middle India, the middle of the India, who were mostly where the Aryans settled. So they were the people described by the Indo-Aryans. So Indo-Aryans who were in India, they described them as Anas, Dasas and Dayusas. Then you have the Mongoloid. Mongoloid group is subdivided into two branches. So under Mongoloid, we have two groups. That is Mongoloid, Palo-Mongoloid and Tibeto-Mongoloid. Tribal groups in Himalayan region and those in Northeast area. So Northeast area in today's Mizoram, Assam, your Sikkim, all of those you can see people with Mongoloid race. Okay, so you have so many people who, for example, Indian also you can see people with Mongoloid race. Okay. Himalayan region and those in the northeast are Mongoloid stock. Some Mongoloid features are seen in the non-tribal population of eastern state Assam, West Bengal, Manipur and Tripura. So we have people, the Mongoloid race people who live in Assam, West Bengal, Manipur and Tripura region. The West Brassipipeds are subdivided into Alphenoid and Dinaric and Arminoid groups. So we have three groups under Western Brassipipeds. They are Alphenoid, Dinaric and Arminoid group. Alphenoid and Dinaric characteristics are seen in some of the groups of Northern and Western India. So people, where can we find the people of Western Brassipipeds race in? Is in Northern Western. And the Parsis belong to the Arminoid section. So we have the language, right? Parsi language. So they also belong to the Arminoid group. Next, the last one is the Mediterranean. The Mediterranean are associated with the Dravidian language. So Dravidian, when you say Dravidian only, we can have the group, they are the South Indian people. So Dravidian language and cultures. The Nordics were the last major ethnic element to arrive in India and make a profound impact on its culture and society. So the Nordics are the last group of people who had come to India. Okay, so dwell in India and make a profound impact on Indian culture. So Nordics are the people who have changed, not changed, made a major change in Indian society and culture. But before they came, a unique civilization had slowly developed in India. So before Nordic peoples have come, only some kind of new civilization had been found in India. It is known as the Indus Valley Civilization. So when the Nordic came, before that we had the Indus Valley Civilization. Next, moving on to origin of Indian civilization. So how did our Indian civilization came up and which is our first civilization, we'll be looking into it. So we all know. So I think last year you would have done Indus Valley Civilization, the famous, everyone in history classes, like during your school, everybody would have studied about Indus Valley Civilization, which is a famous civilization of India, and it is also known as the Harappan Civilization. It is believed that the Indus Valley Civilization was a joint creation of Aryans and pre-Aryan inhabitants of India. So Aryans are the people who had come from Middle East. They had come and settled and they started the Indus Valley Civilization. The people of Indus Valley Civilization were multi-ethnic. Multi-ethnic means they had different kinds of ethnic groups. Okay, the civilization itself represents the fusion of the contribution of different ethnic streams. Different ethnic means different kinds of people from different society living in. The Indus Valley Civilization is associated principally with the cities of Mohenjo-daro and Harappan. The two sites, that is Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, was excavated by the archaeologist, where we can see through the excavation only we would have come to know that these kind of people lived here. The first ones to be discovered now is Sindh, Pakistan. Later excavation indicate that it had a much wider spread called Diji, Sindh, Pakistan, Kalibagan, Rajasthan, Rawpur, Punjab, India, and Lothal, Gujarat are the important sites of a civilization. Lothal is additionally significant as a proud town. So through excavation, so how is history, how do we believe history? Through excavation, when we dug or when we find some kinds of things and we come to know that yes, people lived here. So we know near Indus River we had the civilization Indus, which has been, now it has been, what is it, it has been declined. So in the skeletal remains of the civilization, there are evidence of presence of proto-asteroid, Mediterranean, Alpine and Mongoloid racial elements. So what kind of social groups of people were living in Indus Valley Civilization are your proto-asteroid, your Mediterranean and your Alpine and Mongoloid racial elements. With no doubt contributed to its growth, it has an urban civilization with a remarkable ability and competency in planning. So they had, during that time only urban civilization was there and we had town planning, and Indus Valley civilization was properly planned. The most important aspect from the sociological point of view is that the foundation of Indian civilization were laid during the phase of some of the elements of period continue to this day. So we can say that Indian society or the sociological aspect of Indian society was being laid back during the Indus Valley civilization time. Of that period continue to this day, the worship of Shiva and the Lingam and the mother goddess can be traced to this period. So we can say during that time only they had believed in gods, and it is said due to the excavation we found that the Indus Valley civilization people had been worshipping Shiva in the form of Linga and also the mother goddesses. So you can see in this picture, these are the sites of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. Next, moving on to the process of Aryanization. So what is process of Aryanization? The Indo-Aryans came later and had no long encounter with the earlier inhabitants of inland. So we had already people living here, but the Indo-Aryans, they had come and they had the encounter between the two groups. They were essentially a pastoral people with a flair for poetry. So the Indo-Aryans, they had a lot of they were educated and they had more tend to write poetry, philosophical speculation and elaborate ritual. They started doing rituals following so many things. They regarded themselves as a superior and tended to look down upon the earlier inhabitants of land, for whom they coined several derogatory terms. They were required to marry within their group. So it is said they had to marry within their group. That is practice of endogamy. Endogamy means which is you marry within the group, within the tribal group, within the clan, and some elementary notions of ritual purity and pollution which is govern their physical. You marry within your group for the sake of saying that purity, pollution, you're not supposed to go out of your group and marry. So these are the one of the procedures. Contacts and commercial interdining relations with others led to the led to the origin of Varnas and also a Jati caste. So what happened as people started mingling with other castes, so the concept of Varna and Jati came. Jati means caste. Commensurately, the sexual relations within different tribal groups and earlier ethnic groups were governed by the customary norms and taboos, and the advent of Indo-Aryans brought in refinements and complication in them. So what happened, earlier people used to they used to marry outside the group, and they used to have life with others. But when the Indo-Aryans came, they made a strict rule that no one will marry outside the group. You have to marry within your group. If you marry outside the group, it is called as pollution. You're polluting your groups and all of those. The ideological and social frame of Indian society began taking shape with the area of interaction between the Indo-Aryans and the earlier inhabitants widened. The Indo-Aryans were divided into three groups. So we had three groups of Indo-Aryans. So they are the Rajanya, Warriors are the aristocracy. So the people used to go to war, okay? The Brahmin, the priest, the Vaishya, the cultivator. So we had three groups, okay? That is the Rajan, Brahmin, and Vaishya. These were Dvija, twice born groups. These people are called as Dvija, means they have born two times. Born first at physical birth and the second time when initially into Varna status. So first time they are being born as a physical status, then being born as a Varna status. Varna means based on the Varna system. The Shudras were the fourth Varna. So you all know the Shudras were fourth Varna. So the classification of today's Varna system is different. Today's Varna system, you have Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. But there you had Rajanya, Brahmana and Vaishya. Then you have the fourth group, which is the Shudra. They were from the outside, the Aryan group, Indo-Aryan group, and were perhaps the progeny of unions between Indo-Aryans and Dasas, were perhaps the pre-Aryan inhabitants of the land. So these people are from the outside the Indo-Aryan groups, okay, from the earlier people. They emerged as cultivator but were denied twice born status. But they were, the Shudras were not given twice born status, okay. Outside the fourfold vertical Varna structure, there was a fifth group. So we had something called the fifth group, the Avarna or the Pancham. Whose ethnic status was low and their occupation so degraded and polluting that they had physical contact low with them was prohibited for twice born and the Shudras. So the Shudras and the fifth group, that is the Panchama, they were denied the twice born group. But the Panchamas they were used to do the low menial jobs, okay. What work they were doing, it is seen as polluted. So the higher caste people will not see them and etc. Jatis, depending upon the origins and the nature of the occupation, were fitted in onto the vertical graded levels. Each Varna had its own hierarchy of Jatis. Some new Jatis were added to the system from time to time. So we had different Jatis, different things. But hierarchy means like you are having the highest of the groups. So as time came, they used to change things. The process of Aryanization of the subcontinental tradition was neither smooth nor complete. It didn't happen completely. It was not smooth also. Its earlier phase was characterized by considerable cultural conflict and warfare. So we had cultural conflict, two groups fighting. For example, Hindu Muslims, let it be two different gangs fighting. Much accommodation and compromises were also taking place. The Indo-Aryans were gradually emerging from the pastoralism to the agricultural economy. So in the Indo-Aryans, they just started moving. They started doing agriculture as well. They necessitated greater harmony with the older inhabitants. In any case, some kind of synthesis between was already taking place. So because of Indo-Aryans coming, they had fights between two groups. As a result, the non-Aryans adopted some elements of Indo-Aryans. So what happened? The people who were not Aryans, they started adapting the culture of Indo-Aryans. Social, while retaining their own ethnic and regional identities, pluralism was being stabilized and the culture mosaic being formed. So what happened because of this, when people started adapting other culture, so for example, normal Indian converted into a Indo-Aryan, so they have to adapt that culture, that becomes a pluralism. Two types of group. For example, you have a Muslim man and Hindu girl marrying each other. So what happened? Two cultures, two religion coming together. So that becomes pluralistic. So for today's class, we'll stop here. Next, we'll continue next class.